This evening, I will be joining Jimmy Dore, Dr. Cornel West, Kyle Kalinske, Justin Jackson, and Breonna Joy Gray, among others, in a Force the Vote town hall to discuss forcing a vote on Medicare for All. As Breonna notes in Current Affairs, progressives in the House could garner support from the Progressive Caucus and hold Pelosi's speakership hostage unless she agrees to bring Medicare for All to the floor, where it can be publicly debated. Former National Press Secretary for the Sanders campaign, contributing editor at Current Affairs, host of the Bad Faith podcast, if I can say it properly, the great one and only Breonna Joy Gray joins me now to talk about this idea and where we are in the fight, because there have been several evolutions and iterations here. But I think it's important to kind of go back to the basics, because to me there are two main pieces here. Number one is, are progressives going to use the power that they actually and leverage that they actually have in the House? And this is the first major test. And then the other piece is, why Medicare for All and why now? So let's take each of those in turn, Breonna, if you would.
Yeah, what's so interesting about this particular debate is this is one of the few moments in recent history where we're not talking about hypothetical power on the left. We're talking about real, actual power. This isn't a question of how many people can we convince to get on board with this. Right now, today, a very small number of progressives have the power to choose to not vote for Nancy Pelosi for speaker. And in doing so, make it so that Nancy Pelosi, a woman who has been really held up by the left as an obstacle to a lot of the substantive goals, policy goals that it has, can be no longer in that position of power, right? We can say that we will vote for her for speaker under certain conditions. Principally that she bring Medicare for All to a floor vote so that we can have a lengthy discussion in the middle of a global pandemic about the failures of our employer-based healthcare system, in addition to a number of other concessions that people like David Sirota have set out, like getting rid of Richie Neal as the head of the Ways and Means Committee and other substantive barriers to advancing a progressive agenda.
And Breonna, this is an obvious question, but I have to ask it anyway, because we should never forget how outrageous it is that this would even be a concession to the left. What percentage of Democrats support Medicare for All? This is a party that is supposed to stand for universal health care. So why is it even like such an incredible ask to get this floor vote in the first place?
I'm glad you asked that, Crystal, because this is a really crucial part of the argument that I think a lot of folks who aren't on board are missing. We don't need to convince more voters to support Medicare for All for the most part. 88% of Democrats support Medicare for All, and yet barely 50% of Democrats in the House, our most representative body, support Medicare for All. So the goal here is to put pressure on elected representatives in the House to align more closely with their constituents. And the reason why they are not, up until now, accountable for the fact that their voting preferences don't reflect the policy preferences of their constituents is because there's no accountability mechanism. The corporate media never asks them why they don't support Medicare for All. In fact, they participate in pushing a lot of the right-wing talking points about how Medicare for All isn't possible. Well, guess what? After years of the failure of our health system, accented by 15 million people getting kicked off of their employer-based insurance in the context of this pandemic, the people don't need to be brought on board. It's their representatives. And outside a kind of stunt that really highlights the gap between what the people want and what the representatives are willing to back, it's unclear that there will ever be an accountability mechanism that makes represented elected officials have to listen to their constituents as opposed to the people who are filling their fundraising coffers.
I mean, it actually strikes me as very similar to the debate right now over the importance of having an up or down vote on $2,000 checks, right? Votes are accountability. Yes. Votes are a way of forcing the issue and exposing to the public the gap between what they want and what the people they elected, including people in the Democratic Party, actually stand for. Let me give you a couple of the pushbacks that are out there, because there's certainly a lot of people that don't agree with this idea all the way around. One of them is, okay, are you really ready and prepared for Speaker of the House Kevin McCarthy?
So that is not a possibility. To be Speaker, you have to get a majority of votes in the House. And because this is a Democratic majority House, barely, but it still is, unless Democrats were to vote for Kevin McCarthy or another Republican, we would not get a Republican Speaker of the House. That's a complete and total straw man. That is not a possible negative outcome of this.
Okay. Here's one of the other pushbacks, which is, look, floor vote on Medicare for all, really not that big a deal. If you're going to use this leverage for something, ask for something bigger.
I completely agree. The floor vote is but one of several asks that should be made at this time. But I would say that it's one of the more important asks because it is the linchpin of this whole thing. It's what gets the media grist and interest going on. Look, we can't forget that Nancy Pelosi is one of the least liked politicians in an already pretty reviled Congress, right? 3/4 of Americans think she should step down. So if you're curious about how to finally get an aloof media's attention on this thing, let's talk about Democrats mutinying and trying to get their own speaker out of office. Fox News will cover it breathlessly, and the corporate left news will also have to pay attention. Moreover, some people have said, well, what's the point of a 15-minute floor vote and debate? Well, here's the thing. Nancy Pelosi also controls how much floor time is given to a debate or hearing on Medicare for All. So part of the ask could, and in my opinion, should be to have at least a full day of hearings on these issues. Make representatives in Congress answer the question why they don't support Medicare for All after millions of their constituents have been kicked off of their employer-based health care insurance. Make them defend the current health care plan in a world where they can no longer argue, if you like your insurance, you can keep it.
All right, one more for you. This is the other pushback I've been hearing. Real Medicare for All activists aren't pushing for this.
I think what we're actually seeing, and I know this because I've been involved in a number of organizing efforts from people involved with DSA, DSA's Medicare for All advocacy wing in particular, talked to a lot of healthcare professionals, students who are in the student wing of PNHP, who are jostling mightily to get the leadership on board and pay attention to these petitions that they've been circulating, which have collected hundreds and hundreds of signatures. And there has been a lot of feet dragging on votes in these organizations to actually see where the membership stands. My perception of things is that organizational leadership is giving a lot of cover for what is genuinely a grassroots movement, a movement that has been able to make this issue trend and be at the real forefront of the lefty discussion for weeks now, a movement that has been so vocal that AOC and a number of other squad members have felt compelled to enter into the fray, and even people like Ilhan Omar have given a tacit nod of approval to this plan. She tweeted out recently that this is real leverage and power that progressives have in this moment, and the floor vote should come with concessions.
Yeah, well, and we've seen, Jamal Bowman, Cori Bush having to respond. Nina Turner also saying, listen, people should use all the tools at their disposal. So I think it's forced an incredibly important conversation. You've been at the forefront of it, Brianna, and I really thank you for that and also for your time today.
Of course, it's my pleasure.
Coming up, friend of the show, Jeff Stein, is going to join us to break down the very latest on those stimulus checks, whether they will be or not be. That's when Rising returns.